Gaming generations come and go, and more often than not, it's each cycle's big games that tend to stick with players. Your Grand Theft Autos, your Halos, Uncharteds, and Zeldas. Understandably, you know, these tentpole titles leave a lasting impression thanks to insane production values, memorable stories and characters and worlds that people love to get lost in. Now that's all good and fair, but in a sea of critically acclaimed games, it's sometimes the flawed ones that I seem to remember most. And despite the lower fanfare, the rough edges of these imperfect games adds to their charm and in a way, their unique sense of identity. There's so many that fit into this category from the last console generation, much more than I could touch on in a single video. And some did better than others commercially, but all were worthy of more appreciation than they ultimately got. So I thought I'd do things a little differently this time around and highlight the games that deserved a little more success. Now, one that immediately springs to mind for me was Singularity. Before being pulled into the Call of Duty machine, Singularity was Raven Software's take on the BioShock formula. Reception was mixed to favorable, but I think it carved out its own niche with an alluring story, detailed environment design, and a unique mechanic called the TMD, or Time Manipulation Device. It took place on a pretty ghoulish and ominous island known as Katorga 12, which was formerly inhabited by Soviets. When a pulse of energy originating there knocks out a US satellite, a team of US recon marines is sent in to investigate and winds up trying to unravel this big conspiracy to find out what really happened. And along the way, you determine what transpired, and with the help of the TMD, travel back and forth in time and space between 1955 and the present, moving objects with you, using stasis and other ways of manipulating time to progress through the island. The writing was actually sharp and it kept you guessing about what was coming next. I can't talk about engaging stories without also bringing up Enslaved: Odyssey to the West. In a shift away from the dreary and desolate, Enslaved painted a colorful and endearing vision of a post-war future akin to something closer to today's Horizon Zero Dawn, for example. It was a gorgeous setting which alone was enough to pull me in. I'm a huge lover of post-apocalyptic scenarios, and as one of my favorites in Ninja Theory's catalog, it's probably the closest anyone's ever gotten to emulating that Naughty Dog experience, for lack of a better term. Platforming, third-person combat, and puzzle solving were all there, but it was the characters and the world that grabbed hold of me. Tasked as the brute monkey, you had to escort Trip home through a New York City reclaimed by nature and vicious mechs. The characters are wonderfully played by Andy Serkis and Lindsay Shaw, and the combat was a little one-note and traversal played it a little safe, but like Joel and Ellie in The Last of Us, Trip and Monkey grew close over the course of their journey to the point that I was actively rooting for their success. I've been itching for a sequel so bad because the cliffhanger of an ending still stings today. Speaking of an itch, might that be from those demonic powers you've just acquired? The Darkness was such a cool shooter with some seriously immersive atmosphere for its time. By basically mixing Deus Ex and The Chronicles of Riddick: Escape from Butcher Bay, another underrated classic I might add, the developers at Starbreeze crafted a somewhat open-ended world where you play as Jackie Estacado, traveling between areas of Chicago, its subway system, and the other world, a hellish landscape controlled by the evil of the darkness itself. And voiced by the incredibly talented Mike Patton, this demonic being takes hold of Jackie after an attempt on his life is made by the mafia and sticks with him to exact vengeance. Patton absolutely killed the role with some of the most maniacal and menacing vocals I have ever heard in a game.
Take the cipher! Give me its power!
On top of being a fun shooter that puts awesome powers at your disposal, it had a surprisingly poignant narrative that delved into Jackie's hard life with some truly touching scenes that I still think about. Like Jackie sitting comfy on a couch with his girlfriend Jenny and just watching the entirety of To Kill a Mockingbird. Its sequel didn't quite live up to its full potential, but I consider The Darkness to be one of my favorites of last gen for thinking outside the box of a standard mobster story. Now, Binary Domain is another one I consider to be the definition of an overlooked gem. It was the first game promoted under the RGG studio name, now known for the popular Yakuza franchise. Now, you played as Dan Marshall in this Japanese spin on Gears of War, working alongside the Rust crew, which stars Big Bo, who I can only assume is modeled after Delroy Lindo, I think? Anyways, you had to investigate a conspiracy involving the Japanese robotics corporation Amada and the US-based company Bergen. A rogue attack on Bergen sets off this pulpy conflict with the rise of humanoid robots. Now, robots were genuinely fun to shoot, with individual parts, limbs, and circuitry flying around in chaotic destruction and massive boss battles. There was a cool dynamic between the rest of the characters, and the ending you got changed depending on your choices made through the story and how your team felt towards you, which added to the game's appeal. It sold pitifully here in the States, unfortunately, but it's well worth your time if you get a chance to check it out. In keeping with the theme of titles that laid on the charm, Overlord saw you control legions of little minions, each with different colors and unique abilities, to take on and defeat the seven heroes that slew your predecessor, i.e. the Overlord. And the art style was bright and colorful, and it was such a blast to see all your little baddies rampage across the levels, beat up the good guys, and just be enthusiastically evil. So fun. Some were focused on melee while others could swim or withstand poison gas. It was like being given free rein of the Rugrats and telling them, have at it, destroy, and crack some jokes while you're at it. If you grabbed Pikmin, tossed it in a blender with some lighthearted evil and a bit of satirical parody, congrats, you just got Overlord. Now, around that same time, long before Dark Souls and Bloodborne became household names, From Software was known for its love of mechs with the Armored Core series, but one slipped through the cracks. Now, while admittedly rougher on the edges, Chrome Hounds was a hardcore mech simulator where, quote, hounds battled for control of a fictional region near the Black Sea. It played much, much slower than Armored Core, deliberate in its pacing, and its story was kind of forgettable, but the process of designing, building, and customizing your own giant mech with unique capabilities and heading into battle against other players really was a thrill. You could spec for close or long range combat, swift and light, or slow and heavy. There was a special rush that came from aiming artillery barrages with your howitzer from miles away and hitting opponents. The online campaign mode was so neat to watch unfold in real time as clans of people battled each other for dominance of territories, like an online version of Risk. I can only imagine what a modern day sequel would look like today. But a more modern vision of a beloved IP is precisely what we got in Castlevania Lords of Shadow, and it stands as one of the most underrated installments in the series. Now, the honor of the first 3D Castlevania goes to Castlevania on the N64, but Lords of Shadow took it much, much further thanks to great pacing, character performances from actors like Patrick Stewart. It transformed the 2D combat into an engaging action game that was pretty reminiscent of something like God of War and Devil May Cry, with some of the most gorgeous visuals of its time. The musical score instilled the idea of adventure, and you were always learning a new move or trick every hour to give you a sense of progress. Mercury's team admirably translated the Castlevania formula to 3D, and for that they'll always have my appreciation. Play this game. And actually, throw simple appreciation to the side for a sec. Shinji Mikami should have received a medal for Vanquish. And sure, the narrative was a bit on the shorter side and the voice acting was eh, but come on, they strapped goddamn rocket boosters to your legs and told you go slide around the battlefield like a badass in one of the coolest mech suits ever, shoot goons and do gymnastics simultaneously, all in bullet time. Basically, let's mix Devil May Cry and Max Payne. Vanquish really was the epitome of a fun time that never took itself too seriously, and it worked.
35, provide air support.
Now, I could go on and on down a whole list of games deserving of more attention, but the one I feel got the worst treatment was none other than Spec Ops The Line. It had all the hallmarks of your typical third-person shooter. With its gritty facade, bro-team dynamic, and violent combat, you'd be forgiven if you expected nothing more than what's on the surface, but dig deeper and it was a remarkably well-made video game with a powerful message that purposefully used shooter genre cliches and tropes in order to show you how ridiculous it all was in comparison to real warfare. While most shooters reveled in their violence, Spec Ops submerged itself in the horrors of it. The narrative wasn't meant to be fun, per se, but an eye-opener to drive home the brutality and unwinnable tragedy of war. I'd even say many parts of it were made to make the player uncomfortable. I'm still thinking about how much it surprised me today. I mean, it was sadly considered a commercial failure, and it's a damn shame because Jaeger development had something special on its hands that deserved so much more spotlight than it got. It was enlightening for me to look back on these titles because it showed me that some of the most compelling experiences I found in games aren't the ones with 90 plus Metacritic scores that many players are laser focused on, but the ones just underneath the surface of that threshold that tried to do something new along the way. It was their imperfections that weirdly stuck with me. If you ever get a chance to try some of these, please do. I think you'll find they're well worth your time.